Thank you. Good morning, Cokesbury. Good morning. It's great to greet you and to welcome you to worship this morning. Kathy, where is Kathy? Where? Oh, Kathy's going to come on up. This morning I thought, because tomorrow is such a significant day and we've been working toward it for a long time, I thought I'd give Kathy a chance to share a few things with you. So come on up.
So neighbors, friends, whoever, can just show up at 5:30 tomorrow, right here in this room. And we have a little video with some fun of the past week. Thank everyone who's been here so far. And there's still opportunities if you want to come one night and help serve chicken nuggets or do some greeting or something like that. Just see me and we'll get you plugged in. Thank you.
Kathy, thank you. Yeah, tomorrow begins. It's been a few years, I think, since we've had VBS, but we're back in the saddle getting that going. I want to welcome you as well. On behalf of our entire congregation, we want to welcome any guests who are here today. We're most especially glad that you're worshiping with us. And to our folks who are joining us via Facebook Live, we are delighted to have you as well. They said I lost my mic. I thought she said I lost my mind. I was about to say, sister, you just now figuring that out? Let me lead you in a prayer, and let's invite God's Holy Spirit to visit with us in this time. Almighty God, we come now to this moment, and we invite your Holy Spirit to come and be present with us in all that takes place. Lord God, be honored and glorified. As we lift up your name in praise, Lord, we pray that you would be pleased, for we give you honor and glory and praise. In the name of Jesus, our Lord. Amen. Our first hymn is Joyful, Joyful, We Adore Thee. Phil's going to come and lead us. Let's stand as we sing.
Thank you.
the Spirit of the Lord is, there is one true church, apostolic and universal, whose holy faith let us now declare. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. The third day he rose from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Prepare our hearts for prayer. We invite God's Holy Spirit to come and draw near to us. I want to remind you that this coming Tuesday at 10 a.m., the Celebration of Life service will be held for Walter Scales at Oaklawn. And I invite you, as I know some of you will be going, I invite you to attend that and to be in prayer for Sarah and for that entire family, the Scales family. And I also want to invite you to be in prayer this next week for our Vacation Bible School. It's a big, big deal. Lots and lots of work going on behind the scenes, things people never see that make something like this happen. And so be in prayer for those volunteers who are helping, but also for the kids who come. The goal is to show them Christ, to direct them more toward Christ. And if we can accomplish that, then we will have accomplished the most important thing of all. And Penny, I saw Charlie. I was a pretty good thing with Charlie. I didn't realize he was such a good actor there. He did a great job with his invitation to VBS. Was Charlie up there? Oh, there he is. Yeah, there he is. Okay. Yeah, he's a star. Would you bow your head as we pray together? Gracious and loving God, for the mercy of your forgiveness and for your goodness and for your blessing, we give you thanks for this moment, for this time. Oh God, we thank you. May your Holy Spirit permeate this place. May your Holy Spirit speak into our hearts so that we may be different than when we came in, when we leave this place. That we will know that we have been in the presence of the living God. And in your presence, we are never the same again. Today, O God, we lift up to you the names of those who are not well physically, those known to us, those known completely to you. And we pray for your healing of the body and the mind and the soul and the spirit. We pray for those, O God, who feel they need you the most today, and we pray for the ones who feel they need you the least. May they know your presence, and in knowing your presence, come to know you. Lord God, today we lift up our nation for the privilege of living in this great place we call America. For the grace that you have shed upon this nation, we thank you and we praise your holy name. We pray for our leaders and those who make decisions that affect the course of history, O God. Be with them, we pray. And for your church, for the privilege we have to be the body of Christ gathered, and when this moment, this time is over, we will scatter into the world to be the body of Christ still. And so, Lord, we pray that you would continue to give us zeal and courage to proclaim Christ and him crucified, him resurrected, and in glory forever. Today, O God, we invite your presence to come and be with us, we ask. In the name of Jesus, amen. and amen. At this time, we're going to invite our ushers to come as we receive God's tithe and our offering. Would you bow your head with me, please? Receive now, O God, the gift we bring to you. For the bounty of your blessings and for your honor and glory, we give you thanks. In Jesus' name, amen.
Far away in the depths of my spirit today, flows a melody sweeter than psalm. In celestial-like strains, it unceasingly falls o'er my soul like an infinite calm. What a treasure I have in this wonderful peace, buried deep in the heart of my soul. So secure that no power can take it away, while the years of eternity to that city of peace, where the author of peace I shall see. That one strain of the song which the ransom will sing in that heavenly kingdom. Sweep over my spirit.
before the choir sings, I'm going to have Dawn come and offer an announcement that I think you'll be very interested in hearing and an opportunity for our congregation.
Good morning, friends. I don't think I've ever been on this one. I feel so important up here. So I have some summertime fun to announce. So this summer, we're doing something that we haven't done before. And we will, on the last Sunday of every month, we will gather at Asbury just for some fellowship and fun. There is no business, there is no fundraiser, it is just us hanging out, having a good time. The first one, we're gonna do a homemade ice cream social. Pastor Bobby would like all the ice cream makers going.
Stop.
It's a vibe. And it's like, yeah, he did say that. And then, he really did. And then all the ice cream fixings, so we're gonna make sundaes, and it's just gonna be fun. And then in July, we're going to do game night. And so we're going to play board games and just different games like that. So bring your game spirit. And we'll have some like game time snacks and stuff like that. And then in August, mic drop, we're doing karaoke, which is super fun. Also, Pastor Bobby was super supportive of that. So please call him out when it comes time, and he will be ready. I know he will. He's smiling now. He's excited. I can tell. And that night, we're going to do a popcorn bar. So if you would like to sign up to bring toppings for the popcorn or homemade ice cream in your maker, you know, got to plug it in. So we plug that in and bring all the toppings. And then in July, we'll do game snacks. But if you want to click on the link in the e-news for Sign Up Genius, you can go and sign up for whatever you might like to bring. Whatever works for you, or there's a sign-up sheet in the atrium right now. If you'd like to help plan, reach out to me, because that's fun too, and we just hope to see you all. It's going to be so fun, and we're really looking forward to it. Thanks, y'all.
Thank you.
When I am down and oh, my soul so weary, when troubles come and my heart burdened me, then I am still and wait here in the silence until thank you.
I don't know a lot about music, but I know that's a tough piece to do. Good job, Steph. Really, really well done. Thank you, choir, for your assistance, as always. Yes. If you're going to clap, clap now. Come on. None of this half-hearted business. Either do it or don't do it. Today begins of course, our summer series. I'm going to talk more about that in just a moment. I got a call this morning. I arrived at church, and I got a call, and the voice on the other end said, "Hey." I said, "Hello? It's Josh." He sounded like a deep bass. Phil, you'd have been proud to have him in your choir. He sounded terrible. He said, "I don't think I'm going to make it." And I said to him as caringly and lovingly and pastorally as I could, "Don't come," because he sounded terrible. He said he felt bad and he was cold and that kind of thing. So I told him to get to the doctor. So I know that he would appreciate your prayers this morning. Our scripture for today comes from the Gospel according to St. Luke. We know from history that Luke was the physician. That was what he did. That was his profession, and physicians are interested in details. Aren't you glad your physician's interested in details? We want our physicians to be interested in details. But he is a very detailed writer in the Gospel of Luke. As you read it, you will certainly see that. He also wrote the book of Acts. Today we'll read from the 18th chapter of Luke, Luke chapter 18, verses 9 through 14. Will you please stand for the reading of God's holy word and God's words of life for us for today? He also told this parable to some who trusted in themselves that they were righteous and regarded others with contempt. Two men went up to the temple to pray, one a Pharisee and the other a tax collector. The Pharisee, standing by himself, was praying thus, "God, I thank you that I am not like other people, thieves, rogues, adulterers, or even like this tax collector. I fast twice a week. I give a tenth of all my income." But the tax collector, standing off, would not even look toward heaven, but was beating his breast and saying, "God, be merciful to me, a sinner. I tell you, this man went down to his home justified rather than the other. For all who exalt themselves will be humbled, but all who humble themselves will be exalted." This is the word of God for us, the people of God. Thanks be to God. You may be seated. One of the things I love to do, especially in the summer, is to preach a series of sermons on dealing with a specific subject, a series of 3, 4, 5, in this case, more sermons dealing with a specific kind of subject, a challenge for Christian people. And I want to follow that practice this summer as well. So we're beginning today a series of messages I'm calling In the Grip. In the Grip. Vice Grips. But before we get into this series, I want to ask that you do this. I want to ask that as this series of messages unfolds, I want to ask that you would make it personal. You know, it's always good to go to church and say, "Boy, that was a great message. So-and-so should have been here to hear it today. That would have been great for them. They really needed that sermon. That was something they really..." Or to call them on the phone, God forbid, and say, "Boy, you need to really listen to that." No, I want to invite you, particularly in this series of messages, to offer this prayer. Lord, What do you want to teach me through this subject? The other thing that's necessary is for us to not only look at the subject, but where God might be calling us. Any preacher worth a grain of salt will not only talk about the subject or the issue, but also talk about where it is God calls his people to go. In this particular case, from the vice to the virtue. The vice to the virtue. Would you bow your head and pray with me for a moment? Almighty God, we ask now that your Holy Spirit would speak into our hearts, permeate our spirits, we pray, that we might evaluate ourselves in the light of your holiness. In Jesus' name, amen. Back in the Middle Ages, there were some monks who decided they wanted to try to live a life of total and complete holiness. A life without sin. A life of complete holiness. These monks had a thought process that went something like this. If I just separate myself from the world and I get into a holy environment, like a monastery, then I'll be able to more fully concentrate on being the holy person God calls me to be. That was the thinking, so that by living this life altogether separate from the world, they could become pure and good and holy. So that's what they did. They separated themselves and went into a monastery for the simple purpose of living a holy life. That was the goal. That was the point. What they discovered was that over their lifetime and over a period of years of attempting this practice, what they discovered was that they were, in fact, able to avoid certain things. You know, you get out of the world, you can avoid some things. Get away from all the temptation, you can avoid some things. But there were some things, some dangers, some sins that seeped even through the walls of the monastery. Some things they could not avoid, some things that they could not get away from regardless of where they were. And they identified seven kinds of sins they called mortal sins. Any of our Catholic sisters and brothers, anybody knows anything about the Catholic Church, knows that there are the mortal sins and there are the venial sins, right? The mortal sins are threats to the human soul, threats to human freedom, threats to a genuine relationship with God. The mortal sin is the greatest of all the sins. These were the things they identified. Pride, envy, anger, sloth or laziness, greed, gluttony, and lust. These came to be known as the what? The seven deadly sins, right? These came to be known as the seven deadly sins. And so I thought for the next few weeks we could look at some of those and talk a little bit about each one of them and talk about not only what it means, what it is that is going on in our lives as it relates to this, but where it is that God is calling us, from the vice to the virtue, from the vice that grips us to the virtue God calls us toward. So today is the first in that series, and I want us to look at the vice grip of pride. How do we move from pride to humility? How do we move from the vice to the virtue? If the vice that's identified is this, then how do we go from here to here? Now, in all fairness, and as an aside, I need to say that pride is a word that can have some very positive connotations as well. Pride, appropriate pride, is not a bad thing necessarily. So I looked it up. And what we're talking about here in relationship to this is destructive pride. Here was the first definition I found. Excessive self-esteem and overly self-assured. Excessive self-esteem and overly self-assured. Self-esteem is a good thing, right? To have a realistic and positive image of yourself, Jesus taught us to love ourselves and to love our neighbor as ourselves. So it's a positive thing to have some pride, to have good self-esteem, but excessive self-esteem, overly assured, is a spiritual malady. That's what we're getting at here. The issue of struggling with pride over the top, not healthy, in fact, quite unhealthy. One of the great saints of the church said, when speaking of the deadly seven deadly sins, he said, if the sins are the tree, then the trunk is pride. Get that image. If the sins are the tree, then the trunk is pride. In other words, all the other vices are anchored and rooted in pride. And in the scripture for today, Jesus tells a story, as he was wont to do. He tells a story about two men. We call it a parable. Anytime Jesus told a story, it wasn't just for entertainment. When Jesus told a story, it had a deeper spiritual lesson to it. And in the passage for today, Jesus tells a story about two men who went to church to pray. They went to the temple to pray. Now, typically, when a devout Jew prayed, he lifted his eyes toward heaven and he stretched out his hands this way. And he offered his prayer verbally, out loud. And that's what he did. That's what the Pharisee did. So he looked up toward heaven and he said, God, I thank you that I'm not like other people. I mean, I fast and I pray and I give a tenth of my income. I'm a keeper of the law, Lord. And most especially do I thank you that I'm not like him. Most especially do I thank you that I'm not like the tax collector over here. The tax collector, on the other hand, the passage tells us, couldn't even bring himself to look up. Instead, he looked down. He beat upon his chest, which was a symbol of deep, deep sorrow and remorse. He beat upon his chest and he cried out, God, please, please have pity on me. Please have mercy on me, O God, a sinner. It is then that Jesus draws the lesson. He would tell the parable and then he would give the lesson. It's then that Jesus draws the lesson. He says, those who seek to make themselves great will be humbled. They will be humbled. And those who humble themselves will be made great. I also love what the Old Testament has to say on this subject of pride. In Proverbs chapter 16, verse 18, it says, pride goes before destruction and a haughty spirit before a fall. Or, as I grew up hearing it, pride goeth before a fall. Pride goeth before a fall. Again, it's a matter of pride being the trunk of the tree. And until we deal with this issue, that's why it's first. Until we deal with this issue and search our lives and search our hearts and tell the truth about areas in our lives where pride is an issue, until we do that, until we have the unmitigated courage and audacity to do that, all the other messages are pointless. Because it has to start with what we're willing to address. Now listen carefully. Because God won't correct what you're not willing to confront. God won't correct what you're not willing to confront. And so we have to start with where the root is, where its core is. God won't correct what you're not willing to confront. Pride, excessive self-esteem, and overly self-assured. I've always loved the story that Dr. Reggie Mallett told at Lake Junaluska a number of years ago. He told a story about a Texan who made his way to first visit to London, England. And this particular Texan was a proud Texan. You know, he was, everything's better and bigger in Texas. Everything's better and bigger in Texas. That was his thing. And the English tour guide who escorted that Texan around London was a taxi driver. And as they drove past, on the very first day, as they drove past the front of a very large, impressive building, the Texan said, Whoa, what's that thing? And the taxi driver said, Why, sir, that is the Tower of London. He said, Well, how long did it take them to build that thing? Oh, sir, it took William of Normandy and his sons 40 years to build that. And the Texan said, Ha! We could have built that thing in 40, 45 days in Dallas. Could have taken care of it just like that. And so they continued on their journey and passed on in front of another impressive building. And again, the Texan said, Whoa, what's that thing? And the taxi driver responded, saying, Sir, that is St. Paul's Cathedral. And the Texan again said, Well, how long did it take them to build that? And the taxi driver said, Oh, sir, it took Sir Christopher Wren and his men 35 years to build St. Paul's Cathedral. And the Texan said, Ha! We could have built that thing 3 or 4 months down in Dallas. No big deal. Well, the Englishman's getting a little agitated. He's getting a little aggravated at this pride. And so he's irritated. And as they were riding across Westminster Bridge, they looked up, and in front of them was this incredible panorama. Westminster, the House of Commons, Big Ben, Westminster Abbey, the opulent palace of Westminster. And true to form, again, the Texan said, Whoa, what's that thing in front of us? To which the taxi driver said, Why, sir, I don't know. It wasn't there when I came by this morning. The Bible reminds us that pride goes before a fall. Before a person falls, their heart is filled with excessive self-esteem, overly self-assured. So if pride is the vice, and if it can be our downfall, and it has been for many, many people, you know this. And if pride can cost us relationships with people we love, then it stands to reason that it's a big deal. It stands to also reason that it will not correct itself. Instead, it is corrected when confronted with daily, intentional, habitual desire to have God create within us a greater spirit of humility. Now, I just said a lot right there, and I don't want you to miss it. Pride is confronted when, with a daily, intentional, habitual desire, we ask God to cultivate in us a spirit of humility. Pride is addressed when we understand what Martin Luther meant and when he said, We are nothing, and only when we see ourselves as nothing will God be able to make something of us. The vice of pride is addressed, listen carefully, and put into practice like the prayer that Mother Teresa wrote. She was working with a leper colony in India, and she wrote this prayer, Precious Lord, make me nothing, so that in you and through you and for you, I can become all things you want to your children. So, what does this thing do to us? Spiritually speaking, what does pride tend to do to us? Well, I just want to mention a couple of things. First of all, pride is a deadly sin because it blinds us to the truth that we are dependent. And we are. When we have an excessive self-esteem, an overly assured spirit, we think we are in charge of everything. We think we're in charge of life and we can't ever be wrong. We're always right. We think we're totally in control. It's our life. We can handle it. We can handle our lives. We don't need any help. When the Pharisee prayed, friends, I submit to you that he didn't need God at all. If you listen to his prayer, he didn't express any need at all for God. He just makes it clear that he's already arrived. He makes it clear that he's already made it spiritually. Now, understand this. This man's problem, this Pharisee, this man's problem was not that he was a hypocrite. His problem was not that he was claiming virtues he didn't have. No, he had these virtues. His sin was not hypocrisy. His sin was pride because he believed himself to be better than others. And he really didn't need God. Pride blinds us to the truth that we are dependent. The greatest people I know, the greatest people I have ever known, have been people who understood a radical dependence on God. I'm about to tell you a secret. The more mature you become as a Christian, the more you realize your radical dependence on God. One of the great signs of maturity in a Christian is their radical need for dependence, complete dependence on God. That, friends, is a sign of maturity. When I was growing up, Phil, we used the old Cokesbury hymnals, and there was a hymn in there entitled, "I Need Thee, Oh, I Need Thee, Every Hour I Need Thee. Oh, bless me now, my Savior, I come to Thee." I read the other day a quote from the late Billy Graham. Billy Graham, when he was 98 years old, was asked about his ministry and how he would characterize it. And here's what Dr. Graham said at 98. He said, "I was never a great intellectual. There were thousands of better preachers than I. And if God had ever taken his hand off my life, my lips would have turned to clay." Listen to that. If God had ever taken his hand off my life, my lips would have turned to clay. This is a spiritual giant, America's pastor. And here he is saying, "I wasn't the smartest, I wasn't the greatest preacher. But most importantly, if God had ever taken his hand off me, I would have been totally useless." Pride blinds us to the truth that we're dependent, and we are. The second thing the vice of pride does is it blinds us to the truth that we are sinners, and we are. We're not just dependent, but we're sinful. The Bible makes it abundantly clear. All have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. And yet, as I look at the parable of Jesus, I'm aware that the Pharisee, as he prays, is totally unaware of his dark side. You know, Carl Jung, the great psychiatrist, talked about the shadow side, or the shadow self, he called it. And he says, in every human being, there is a shadow side. There's a dark side. There's a side that we don't want anybody to ever know about. There's the inner dark side. And if you listen to the prayer of the Pharisee, you realize he's not in touch with that at all. Nowhere in his prayer does he say, "God, I need you. God, I need you. I need you." Someone has said, life is at its best when we learn to practice three phrases: "I'm sorry," "I was wrong," "I love you." I'm sorry, I was wrong, and I love you. Now, listen carefully to what I'm about to tell you, okay? I wish I could just open up, and I can't do that, but I wish I could just open up and tell you how many relationships, how many marriages, how many friendships, how many work relationships have ended because somebody couldn't say, "I'm sorry." How many great, important relationships have come to an end and have been severed because someone couldn't say, "I was wrong. I'm sorry. This is my fault. And the reason often is because some people believe that saying you're sorry means that you're weak. And as a result, marriages end, or they get colder and colder. Friends don't speak to each other. People that say they care about each other won't talk to one another. But the most significant reason of all that pride is a sin is because we unconsciously come to a point where we really don't believe we need God. We really, somewhere along the way, convince ourselves that I can handle this on my own. I don't really need God. And then life will deal us a blow that will drop us to our knees. Do you know what I'm talking about? Life will deal you a blow that will drop you to your knees. Often, that's the time when people realize they got to have help. They got to have a help that they can't do themselves. They got to have a help that is divine. That's what happens. Pride teaches us that we're independent and that we're not sinful. But pride also encourages us to compare ourselves with others. That's what the Pharisee did. That was part of his problem. He compared himself to the tax collector. Listen, comparison is always destructive, because when we compare ourselves to other people, we will either feel superior or inferior, and there's always somebody superior to you. There are lots and lots, and did I say lots? There are lots of preachers better than I am. If you're proud of your beauty, there are lots of people more beautiful than you are. If you're proud of your intellect, if you're proud of what you've achieved, or I'm independent, I'm self-made, I want you to know there's somebody more than you are. So if this is the issue, if this is the problem, what is God calling us to? If this is the vice, what is the virtue? Well, we say again, the virtue is humility rooted in Christ. And that begins this way, friends. First, it begins with a confession, repentance, and honesty with yourself and with God. I'm going to say this one more time. God will not correct what you will not confront. God will not correct what you're not willing to confront. Coming to a point where you realize, I can't do this on my own. I can't do this on my own. Or I am not this way. Or this is bigger than I am. Rather than having your ego stand between where you are and where God is, the moment of confession, the moment of repentance, the moment of saying, God, I need you. I need you every hour, as the old song says. I've discovered that if you really want to know the truth about yourself, now listen to this. I've discovered if you really want to know the truth about yourself, don't ask yourself. Because people can fool themselves into thinking things, can't they? 10 feet tall and bulletproof. Yes, I am. No, if you want to know the truth about yourself, find somebody who loves you and who loves you enough to tell you the truth about you. I'm not asking you to find a critic, somebody who's after you, or somebody who says that you can't do anything. I'm saying find somebody who loves you enough to tell you the truth about you. And have the gall and the courage to be able to ask them, is pride an issue for me? Am I blind to this? Is this something that's an issue for me? And dadgummit, listen to them. Listen to them when they tell you the truth. Because they're not out to get you. They're out to help you. Because very often the people who love you, you will alienate them because you are too prideful. Find people who love you and ask them to help you. And then confess it to God. Confess it to God. You know what I've discovered? I've discovered that when I confess something to God, I don't do it just once and I'm done. You know, some people think, well, I just handle it, I bring it to God, and I'm done with it. Guess what? It doesn't go away, does it? The issue doesn't go away. Confession is an ongoing thing. It's what Mr. Wesley called our walk toward holiness of life and character. That's what it calls us to be. Today, as we close our worship, I want to invite you to examine your heart as we prepare ourselves for Holy Communion and as we ask God to speak to us. Today, we're going to prepare for Holy Communion, and as we do, I want to remind you that when we come to Holy Communion here, we examine our lives, and this table is open to everyone, and you are invited to come. Let us prepare to receive Holy Communion. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is right to give our thanks and praise. It is right and a good and joyful thing always and everywhere to give thanks to you, Father Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth. You formed us in your image and breathed into us the breath of life. When we turned away and our love failed, your love remained steadfast. You delivered us from captivity, made covenant to be our sovereign God, and spoke to us through your prophets. And so, with your people on earth and all the company of heaven, we praise your name and join their unending hymn. Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. Holy are you, and blessed is your Son, Jesus Christ. Your Spirit anointed him to preach good news to the poor, to proclaim release to the captive and recovery of sight to the blind, to set at liberty those who are oppressed, and to announce that the time had come when you would save your people. He healed the sick, fed the hungry, and ate with sinners. By the baptism of his suffering, death, and resurrection, you gave birth to your church, delivered us from slavery to sin and death, and made with us a new covenant by water and the Spirit. When the Lord Jesus ascended, he promised to be with us always in the power of your word and Spirit. On the night in which he gave himself up for us, he took bread, broke it, gave it to his disciples, and said, "Take, eat, this is my body given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." When the supper was over, he took the cup, gave thanks to you, gave it to his disciples, and said, "Drink from this, all of you, for it is the cup of the new covenant poured out for you. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." And so, in remembrance of these your mighty acts in Jesus Christ, we offer ourselves as a praise in living thanksgiving and holy living and sacrifice in union with Christ's offering for us as we proclaim the mystery of faith. Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again. Pour out your Holy Spirit on us gathered here, and on these gifts of bread and wine, make them be for us the body and blood of Christ. By your Spirit, make us one with Christ, one with each other, and one in ministry to all the world, until Christ comes in final victory, and we feast at his heavenly banquet. Through your Son, Jesus Christ, with the Holy Spirit in your holy church, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty Father. Amen. And now let us pray the prayer that Jesus taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. I want to invite those who are assisting in serving Holy Communion to come forward. Bill, you, and Carrie, and Faith. Shed for you. Blood of Christ shed for you. Drew, I'm going to get you to help get someone to help serve with you, and we'll take communion together as well. This time you're invited to come and receive the Holy Sacrament. Broken for you. Body of Christ given for you. The body of Christ given for you. The body of Christ given for you. The body of Christ given for you. Broken for you. Body of Christ 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 broken for you. Christ broken for you. The body of Christ broken for you. Just a moment. The body of Christ broken for you.
I have two people to take communion.
Okay.
One is Gary down here, which you know.
Okay. The body of Christ given for you.
Thank you.
think given the moment, we're not going to do our closing hymn this morning, but I do have a bit of a surprise for you. I'm going to ask Diane Deer to come forward, please. Diane comes today desiring to become a member of Cokesbury United Methodist Church. And she and I have had a number of conversations. If you don't know Diane, you need to get to know her. She is a really, really great lady. Will you please stand, ladies and gentlemen? Diane, here before God and before His people, I ask you, do you profess faith in Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior? If so, your answer is, I do.
I do.
Will you be faithful and loyal to Cokesbury United Methodist Church? Will you support it with your prayers, your presence, your gifts, your service, and your witness? If so, your answer is, I will.
I will.
Then we receive you today by professing your faith in Christ and becoming a member of this church from this moment forward unto evermore. God bless you. I know you're... Yeah. Anybody who knows anything knows that Diane's mama was a member of this church too, and so mama's proud of you today. Guarantee you.
She's rolling.
She's rolling, is she? I'm going to ask Faith to come and offer a closing prayer. And Diane will go to the back with us, and I invite you to speak to her as you go today. We welcome her into this body of Christ.
Father, how grateful we are that we can turn to you and you can rid us of the things that are not a reflection of you. Father, help us to see ourselves through your eyes this week, so that we can see others through that same light of love, in the name of Jesus.
So now may the grace and peace of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the fellowship and communion of His Holy Spirit be with you, abide with you, guide you, strengthen you, and sustain you now and forever. Okay.